We call it a strange attractor or a chaotic attractor, infinite complex of surfaces. It shows something called sensitive dependence on initial conditions. So the motion on the attractor, you start with initial conditions basically anywhere, and they will settle down to this thing and then be kind of moving around on it. No matter where they start, they'll settle down to this. But even on this thing, there's sensitive dependence on initial conditions. What do I mean? This term comes up and it needs some describing. And one of the useful ways to describe it is in terms of the Lyapunov exponent. So the idea is if you had two initial conditions, here's an initial condition. And if you were to follow it, it does something. We'll write that as the vector x of t and some other nearby initial condition that's separated just by a small amount. We'll just put the scalar amount delta naught. These two will diverge from each other. So this trajectory is x of t plus delta as a vector t. If we just look at the magnitude and then call that delta without the underscore, delta of t, so the distance between these two trajectories, at time zero, it's just delta naught, and then it grows exponentially. So later, this vector will be, say at this later time, here's delta of t, you have exponential growth. So this goes as e to the lambda t. Lambda is called the Lyapunov exponent. And the way that you would get it is you could plot the natural log of that distance as a function of time. Just take two initial conditions that are, as far as you could tell, on the attractor and just plot this distance between them. What you'll see, if you start with a very small delta naught, you'll see that this will kind of do something and then it will saturate once you've sort of reached the size of the attractor, because this can't go on forever. And this average slope here, the slope will be lambda. You can get at this numerically for the parameters that Lorenz used, you know, R equals 28 and everything. You'd find a Lyapunov exponent of about 0.9. So it's positive. So this is one way to characterize the motion. See if there's a positive Lyapunov exponent. So positive Lyapunov exponent is a signature of chaos. You can't just say there's chaos when you have a positive Lyapunov exponent, because let's say we had the one-dimensional system, x dot equals lambda x, where lambda is something greater than zero. All initial conditions are exponentially growing, and they're exponentially growing away from each other. So, but we wouldn't call this chaos. We'd say, no, that's not chaotic. So there's more to it than that. There's actually a whole collection of Lyapunov exponents. Some people talk about the Lyapunov exponent, but the idea of the Lyapunov exponent is that you've got a small initial sphere or ball of initial conditions. And over a short amount of time, that ball is going to grow in some directions, maybe stay the same in others, shrink in others, so it'll become a ellipsoid. But the main growth is dominated by a particular direction and by a particular growth rate. So over large enough times, all you'll see is the largest Lyapunov exponent. So it's not just the positive Lyapunov exponent. If you have a positive one, yeah, that means there's going to be growth. It's the largest positive Lyapunov exponent. Oh, I forgot to put the word exponent here. But you have, in an n-dimensional system, you have actually n exponents that describe the growth of the infinitesimal ball in the n different directions. And it'll be different depending on where you are in the phase space. But for systems that have attractors like this, things will settle down to the attractor, and then the growth is dominated by this largest Lyapunov exponent on the attractor. And numerically, it seems to be pretty well behaved. Like you should be able to get 0.9 and calculate it. You usually start with some kind of tiny separation, like, I don't know, 10 to the negative 14 or something. Something small. There's more that could be said. What Lorenz was studying this system for was to predict the weather. He was interested in, you know, what are the limits of how far we could predict the weather. It was, and I think now we're at a point where, you know, you go to an app and it tells you 10 days ahead. Around here, I don't trust it worth anything for 10 days. But let's say 10 days is sort of this horizon beyond which you can't predict at all. So we can predict the weather, let's say, pretty reliably, even in Blacksburg, one day ahead. And then it just seems to be dropping off until there's some horizon where you can't trust it at all. What does that even mean? If we started out with two initial conditions that were separated by something just infinitesimal, right? Very, very small. So we've got two initial conditions. Then they would seem to match for a very long time, let's say. And then at some point, they would obviously be peeling off one from the other. And we could say that's when we would detect that there's been a separation. Maybe that tolerance is A, when growth in phase space goes beyond a tolerance that we'll say is A, the deviation becomes noticeable. We would say we can't predict beyond that. So that would be where, if we start with the two initial conditions are separated by delta naught, then we say after some time t, so this would be t of r, the horizon beyond which we say we can't predict. We set a tolerance and say, well, beyond that, it's kind of useless. So once that equals about a, then we can't really predict things. So think of, again, the weather. Right now, we can measure the weather. I don't know exactly how we're doing it. At some point, it becomes noticeable in the phase space of like wind and is there precipitation. And maybe when it's, you know, they're totally decoupled, we could calculate what that time t is. So just from this formula, right, just rewrite it. That's the predictability horizon, t, and just get it from this. Just take the natural log, move the delta naught over. So we've got a over delta naught, natural log of that divided by 1 over lambda. And you know, this is just approximate. This is sometimes called the Lyapunov time. And it's the time beyond which you can't reliably predict. It's due to this Lyapunov exponent, but it's also due to your delta naught related to a. And that's what kills you in terms of trying to increase predictability. Like, let's say we could predict the weather to 10 days. If we wanted to have like a tenfold improvement in the prediction horizon, we want to predict the weather up to 100 days reliably. A stays the same. Because of this natural log, we would need not a tenfold improvement in delta naught, but a 10 to the tenfold improvement in delta naught. Meaning if, you know, whatever delta naught is, some separation in phase space, we would need that to go down by a factor of 10 to the 10. I know this is natural log, but, you know, treat it as log base 10. It's going to be about the same. So that's crazy. That's not going to happen. Even to get a factor of 2 improvement is going to be huge, right? You need to factor of 2 improvement means a hundredfold more precise initial conditions. So simulating differential equations that are deterministic, even if you're off by a little bit from the true, that will grow. And when you start to see it and it's an important enough difference, we call that level of separation our tolerance. So to get even a factor of 2 improvement, you need a hundredfold more precise initial condition, which for the weather might mean, I don't know, putting weather stations in 100 times as many locations. So I think we're doing pretty well if we can predict even 10 days. Let's just be happy about that. Okay. So that maybe we'll say more about the Lyapunov exponent at some other point. I wanted to define chaos, if I could.